Sai Charan from Chennai, who completed my undergraduate studies in Munich University and got a bachelor's in physics. So it is a four-year course where the last year is supposed to be a thesis year. So you do thesis and some electives. The electives do depend on the professors and the level of expertise in each field. So it really depends on the professors. Fortunately, I was able to get my choice of electives. So now I'm currently pursuing my master's at Ludwig Maximillan University in Munich. Yeah, my specialty, I haven't chosen my specialty yet, but it's mostly going to be particle physics, phenomenology, and a bit of theoretical particle physics. So it's going to be a combination of both. I don't want to be a totally mathematical physicist, I want to do physics properly. So with a little bit of reality attached to it, I guess. And that's my preference. And a lot of people can have different preferences, of course. Yeah.
I'm going to come at you with a two-part question. The first part being like, okay, fine, you're interested in particle physics. So how did you land up in saying, okay, fine, like, I'm interested in this particular question or something like that, and I want to try my hand at, answering a few questions here or something here seems,
Okay, I think I get what people feel, but I guess I'm the wrong person to ask these questions because I was always motivated to get into this field from when I started, when I wanted to, do physics. I was okay. So there are a lot of people who get demotivated after seeing a lot of math in physics, but you're not supposed to do that. I get it, but people get an image of physics, a different image of physics before they come into the field, and after they come into the field, they are hit with the harsh truth. So basically, you don't need to technically do anything in your bachelor's, which is very specialized. So that's why it's called a bachelor's. Otherwise, you directly go into a particular field. As as Feynman once said, you try to do all the problems that are put forth in front of you, or sometimes any problem that might interest you, that you might come up with as well. So just don't try to don't be too optimistic, as well as don't be like don't put your problems down. Your ideas might be worth. So yeah, so that's why you should ask questions in class. Okay, sometimes people don't ask questions in class because they think it might be trivial, and that social anxiety dictates that you're supposed to always entertain people, and people don't do that. Just try to ask questions. Even if it's trivial, you might learn something from it. That's what I learned from my first 2 months of master's, because I've gotten into a very hard course, which is supposed to be everybody in that is a PhD in the university. So I'm one of two, three master's people in that course, and those master's people are they're in the second year, in the third semester or something. So they're supposed to take specialized courses. I've taken that course because I thought I knew the stuff. I thought I knew the introductory background, but again, a lot of caveats are there and nuances are there. You might not know, so this is kind of a learning experience for everybody. If you just please try to take advanced courses and don't give up.
Does the professor actually expect you to know a little bit before you come?
No, he does expect. So it's like this in every business, in every field. So they expect you to know stuff. Okay, but you don't need to show them that you know things. You can take your time in between when the course starts. Even if you don't know stuff, you learn at an accelerated rate, and you learn in such a way that you know the basics for that particular course. So for instance, this particular course is based on grand unified theory, if anybody knows it. So grand unified theory is basically unifying all the fundamental forces. So how do you unify all the fundamental forces? How do you put them into one bracket? Is that what physics is all about? Because you want the least number of laws to be able to explain everything in the universe. That's how physicists start out in their career. So I guess to the first question that you asked, how do you end up in this field? It's basically based on your personality. And I'm saying that so you can always change fields in physics.
Okay.
In physics, you can always change fields. Yeah. Depends on you per se.
Okay.
But there are certain fields that have a high threshold to enter, and there are fields that you can directly enter. For instance, mathematical physics is one of the fields where you can directly enter, because it's like computer science. So it is very partitioned. So you don't need to know all the details, mathematics, physics at least. Okay. You don't need to know, it depends on you again. You don't need to know every basic theorem, every basic, you know, construction that is available, very mathematically rigorous constructions available. So you can do applied physics in a partitioned way. But there are certain things that you can't do from the ground up, from the get-go. For instance, the two big fields, astrophysics and particle physics. So you can't do those things without knowing anything. So you need to have a fundamental knowledge of, you know, a lot of other courses. So I would say that you can experiment with the type of courses and type of, you know, I'd say type of topics that you might want to be interested in and you might put the effort in. But at least make a selection at the start. Make a broad selection.
Okay.
There are a few fields you want to be an experimentalist, you be an experimentalist. But I have my doubts on experimental science at this point.
Okay.
I have seen people doing experiments, and I don't think that was supposed to be that was a vision physicists had when they were talking about experiments.
Okay.
So it's kind of I didn't like it. I wanted to do experiments, but experiments are not supposed to be taken as courses, experimental courses. So experimental science, you have to learn by work experience. So a course won't help you. So I've learned that after coming to this master's thing. So we have experimental courses, but the entire course is theoretical. So they teach.
Okay.
So because these experiments, these are high energy experiments and astrophysics experiments, you can't have an entire class of 20 or 30 people and ask them to do this experiment. So you don't have the time, you don't have the manpower, you don't have, first of all, you don't have funding to do all these high level experiments.
Okay.
And even if you get these high level experiments, for instance, let's say you want to do Stern-Gerlach, that's a high level experiment. But so that can be, you know, modified to the lab. So, you know, the quote-unquote lab in schools and colleges, in universities, you can dumb it down to the lab version. But that comes as a whole package. It's like a pre-built PC. Have a button to take readings. That's not experimental science.
Okay.
Get it? So I think that's how you differentiate. So you just focus on experimental or theoretical. Or you can do even, so if you want to do phenomenology, which is basically a combination of both theoretical and experiment, you take data from, you know, experiments and try to match it using theory. I guess that's the particle physics has that field in a boom right now. So everybody's doing that.
To go back to one of the points that you were saying, that you could choose between, say, experimental or theoretical or phenomenology, and then try out different courses irrespective of the level of complexity. Now, when I try out like certain courses, like suppose I do a basic course in, say, biophysics or something. So those of you who don't know, our university has this thing of offering core common collective, wherein it's basically a very dumbed down version of a course, which is basically supposed to introduce you to a certain fields. So for example, if I take something in, say, biophysics and I like that, and I take something else in astrophysics or something like that and I like that as well, now I'm left in this sort of place wherein like there are n number of courses which I'm interested in, but I'm not able to figure out in which direction to proceed to.
Even they don't. So I don't know about the people who took PhDs before right after bachelor's. In fact, you can do that if you study this SNU's 4-year course. You'll be well equipped to study it if you study properly, actually. So you'll be well equipped to tackle a PhD in the US, not in the European countries or I'd say India. So because you need some, you know, bridging courses, you know, so all these things, so you'll have a entry level knowledge, you'll know how to approach the subject. That itself requires a level of understanding, right? You need to know how to understand the subject, you need to approach the subject in some way. So you need to know a little bit of, you know, mathematics and some, you know, physical intuition, some experience. You know, why do these approximations work? Why do certain things stay the way they are? Okay, so as you asked, so the CCCs, I've personally found these to be a waste of time. So for me at least, because I was extremely focused, I knew what to do. So I guess I'm not helping a lot of people here. by saying that, but it depends on you. My personality is basically I want to reduce everything to the core concepts.
Okay.
That's the reason why I took physics, and it's like both ways. I took physics because I like reductionism, and I like reductionism because I like physics. So it's both ways.
Right.
So that, I realized that I like reductionism because after coming into physics, because I like this concept of, you know, going down to the fundamentals and understanding everything so that you build from the ground up. I would say, like, do whatever, so do some philosophy as well, a little bit of philosophy.
Okay.
So that I understand, so physics is a bit of philosophy. I'm not saying, you know, talk pedantically in philosophical terms. I'm just saying, for you, at least, why do you want to do so certain things? And, you know, why do you want to approach certain things? So, and I got lucky by guessing the correct courses, I guess. So, I guessed the correct courses I wanted to do, and again, don't think that if you do a course, you know the subject. If you do well in a course, you know that. Don't make that assumption. You might get an A in this course, and you might not know the subject. That's it. So you want to pick the right courses, and I would say don't waver too much.
Okay.
I mean, you might not like some particular course or particular part of a subject that you have taken. Okay. But that doesn't mean you are going to hate it, because I'll tell you this experience that I had. I did my fourth year thesis in quantum information theory. My third year, you know, we have this opportunities for undergraduate program in an undergraduate research program in SNU. So yeah, I did my research program, third year research and fourth year thesis under the same professor Dr. Santosh Kumar. So, he is a mathematical physicist, but he specializes in random matrix theory. Okay. So, that is not a field that I would like to invest my soul in, my life in. Got it? So, I'm not terribly interested in it, but it's physics still. And it, I always go back to Feynman's, you know, this idea of, you know, Feynman and Max Planck's idea. You know, do whatever is interesting you at the time in physics. Feynman used to do windmill problems, how to, you know, optimize windmill power output. So that has nothing to do with his, you know, Nobel contributions for quantum electrodynamics. He basically rewrote quantum electrodynamics in his own terms. So that has nothing to do with this, but he was a smart guy in general. So, and he was interested in physics. He wanted to do physics in a way. So that's what I'm asking you, you know, I'm urging people to, you know, think about in physics. Okay, so I don't know, physics is very interesting. So every part of physics is interesting, quite interesting. So I would say if you hate a particular topic, hang around it for a little while longer, you might find something that will interest you in the same topic. I don't know, I by the end of my thesis, I was quite fed up with my topic. This, you know, random matrix theory, before publishing actually. I was given 3 or 4 drafts again. So my professor was a stickler to, you know, perfect details. So he wants perfect perfection in everything he does. So that's a very good quality. So you should be organized, and you should be, so don't think of it as like not being cool or anything. So if you're organized, it's cool.
Okay.
You know, it's like Huey Lewis song, Hip to Be Square. So yeah, it's cool to be organized, it's cool to be, you know, motivated and focused. Got it? So that's what I'd say. You just take that particular stream and stick around it.
Okay.
So if, let's say, for instance, I've seen a lot of people interested in astrophysics a lot before starting the, you know, undergraduate sciences.
Yep.
So And the second year, they're to dealt with quantum mechanics and other, you know, higher level stuff. So they lose interest. They're like headless chicken. So they don't know like how to unlearn the, you know, previously learned stuff. So you should try to. So if you are a scientist, okay, we are all scientists. We should know how to unlearn stuff. First of all.
Yeah.
So if you have a classical intuition, that doesn't work in quantum mechanics. Or, you know, other fields.
Yeah, that's
so that's why you have revolutionary new ideas, because they don't work in the near future, because we need to modify the existing theory for the new, range of possibilities. So you need to know how to unlearn. That's why I keep saying. So don't be alarmed if you have a lot of curved space-time equations in general relativity or path integrals, very hard to do, vacuum polarization diagrams and vacuum polarization is easy, very hard to do group integrals and group theory stuff in particle physics, or very tedious integrals in particle physics. Don't be alarmed.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a part of the game. So you stick around it. You got interested in it for some reason at the beginning. So right.
Yeah. So you just shoot at a higher level so that you can learn.
Exactly.
More
exactly. Just, you just have an ego. I can do this. I can try this. I can do this. Just
okay.
Have a small kind of ego that you can succeed. If it's not succeed, I mean like have content learning.
So that you can continue to stick with the field that
you can have content learning experience. Again, you can shift between fields like anything. So you grow wiser by the day.
Okay.
I felt that I grow wiser by the day, because if you let me back in first year, I would do things very differently.
You said in your first year, like the way you would have dealt with a problem or something like that would have been completely different than what you are doing currently, right? So like how has like the undergraduate way of studying and like your project before your UG thesis and then your UG thesis and all of this sort of shaped your current way in which you approach a question?
That's a very good question. That's a very particular nuanced and personal question. So how people progress in life, how do you learn stuff, how do you improve? So I would say I have learned to read physics better.
Okay.
With the quotes, physics, you need to learn how to read physics better. So reading physics means reading equations, reading mathematics better. Mathematics is a language, right?
Yeah.
So learn how to read physics better. You need to you become faster at reading physics, as in any language. Physics is basically the language of nature. So you learn how to, if you know the steps a priori, you know how science progresses, then you can read into things better. So that's what I've learned. So you read into for instance a research problem. So certain papers, to my understanding, a lot of papers overcomplicate stuff. In at least mathematical physics and other fields, where you have, there are cut and dry answers. You can write them down. It's a physics thing, right? It's a physics paper. So you can write the minimal you have. You don't need to make everything mathematically rigorous, because you don't need all those mathematical rigors for physics.
Okay.
Got it? So yeah. People still do, try to, so in quantum field theory at least, people try to check the mathematical rigor once in a few decades. They try to check the mathematical rigor because people do wacky stuff.
Okay.
Yeah, they need to check whether the mathematics is sound, whether the logic is sound. So that's why these people do. But if the logic is sound already, I'm not saying physicists are always right, they might be wrong.
Yeah.
But if the logic is already sound, then don't overcomplicate stuff. But that being said, people who want to pursue this field, particular field of, bookkeeping. So physics is already bookkeeping. The higher scale, it's basically bookkeeping now. J.J. Thompson and people before Max Planck, they used to say physics has become bookkeeping now. The only things that are left in every field are measuring physical constants and physical quantities.
I believe there was a quote wherein someone said, all that's left in physics is just more precise measurements.
More precise measurements. I think that was Philip von Joly. So he was Max Planck's advisor at LMU again. So he was his advisor at LMU. So I'm very honored to be studying the same place.
Was that a motivation for you to join LMU?
Definitely, because it's like a pilgrimage for me. Because I adore, I literally worship Max Planck for this. He's very different from other physicists. He's not very cool, hip. in the literal sense, he was like, he's a take charge kind of guy. He was a very morally sound guy, and he had a lot of dilemmas. He was the head of, I'm just blabbering about Max Planck, but he was head of the Berlin Academy of Sciences, and he had to push the front for the German scientific division during World War I. So it's not an easy job.
Okay.
So Robert Oppenheimer broke down because he had to push the World War II front in American sciences, American nuclear sciences. So he broke down. Max Planck didn't. He lost his son and stuff. So he's a Goliath of a man. So that's what I'm trying to say. So I tried to be like Max Planck. So he said that, okay, even if you don't have anything new to do in physics, this was his reply to Philip von Jolly. He said, if you don't have anything new to do in physics, I just want to experience physics as it is. I just want to read it. It's like a story. It's like a story from beginning to end. I just want to finish the story. Yeah, that's how he revolutionized the concept. He revolutionized, modern science as we know it. Okay. So staying around long after the party has ended will work in physics, will work in science.
That's nice. Now coming to the sort of uninteresting part of academia, I'm probably going to ask you some really basic questions as to how to approach competitive exams and whatnot and
I would say technically you don't need to put a lot of effort in competitive exams, but that's just me. I hate exams. I hate testing ground basically. So that's why I want to leave India, because one big hot pot of testing grounds in India. So you need to write exams. So what about your four-year degree program? What have you studied in a degree program if you had to just write an exam to get into masters?
Yeah,
in India. So jam is quite easy.
Okay.
I guess you can go by it. It's on the same level as mains or something. I don't know. I didn't study for jams. I just gave it. I lost track of the jam application dates for the university. So I didn't even put in my applications.
Damn.
So yeah, it's harder. I don't like the concept of exams because I want to do particle physics wherever I want to go to. Okay, I want to do that. I want to do fundamental science, fundamental physics.
Okay.
And the first question they asked me in the just exam is some damn question on electronics, right?
Yeah.
If I have to learn electronics for my, a problem that I'm working on, I will definitely learn it. So there's no question of competency or whatever.
Okay.
It's still the IITJ mains advanced thing after 4 years. That's what I hate about Indian, education.
Even if you apply abroad or somewhere else, do they expect you to write a certain exams IELTS or GRE?
IELTS is an English exam, so you need to write it because you need to show them. No. Most universities in Europe, at least, they don't require any sort of. It depends on the university again, and high level universities require IELTS.
Okay.
But mid-level requirement, mid-level university, I'm talking about mid-level in the top 100, so don't be alarmed. Yeah, the mid-level that I'm talking to are all in the top 100 universities in Times ranking, at least. Times ranking, I've taken a look at the other rankings, but Times ranking I stick to, because IELTS, I would advise people to write IELTS instead of TOEFL.
Okay.
That's a personal advice I give to people. Don't write TOEFL, because TOEFL is conducted by the ETS organizations. It's very money-minded. Every organization is money-minded, very money-minded, but it's just ruthlessly money-minded, because they would ask you to pay a fee for every university you need to send the TOEFL grades to.
Okay.
After these default universities of four universities, you select, before writing the exam, you need to select four default universities that they will send the grades to once the grades are ready.
Okay then.
Okay. That doesn't make sense at all. I don't know where I want to apply before writing the exam.
That's true.
So the exam I write, no, I don't write, I like to put all my exams before I want to apply. So I write a little earlier. So I didn't know I had last minute changes. I wanted to apply to LMU and I wanted to apply to a lot of other universities as well at the start. So, but those plans changed because I wanted to apply to University of Zurich. And I learned that, okay, yeah, they had a little bit of fee, education, tuition fee. In Munich, there's no tuition fee, so that's where I wanted to go. Munich is again, so Zurich is again in the top 20 universities. And it's again, it depends on where you want to go. If you want to be extremely competitive or you want to enjoy life as well, right? You want to be, so that's why you don't want to, you guys, to, you know, stay in India, because you don't get to enjoy life in India if you are an Indian physicist. You don't have this work-life balance in India, that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, that's quite a story that every like PhD person from India has given out. We have our guide helping us out. Like for 5 or 6 years, we are like pursuing the same PhD or something, but like there are no results or something. Yeah.
So, I don't think you need to expect results. I mean, it's still, you need to be an adult, you need to start earning, and you need to sustain yourself. But still, PhDs, you get a decent enough salary, decent enough stipend, so that you can weather through it.
Okay. So then,
I mean, don't be alarmed. So don't think about all those things right now.
Yeah.
PhD is I don't know. So I'm in my first master's thing, and I overthought about this, and this is not going to work if you overthink the stuff. Just need to sometimes you just need to proceed with minimal thought, responsible for your actions.
So then, once you decided that you had to like go abroad for your master's,
By the way, I'm still in Chennai. I'm still in India. So because of the Rona, I'm still continuing online classes from Chennai.
Basically, the question now that I would ask is, once you say, okay, fine, you're going to go abroad for your master's, now how do you go about like saying, okay, fine, these are the institutes that I'm looking to apply for, and these are some things which are, you know, my second option or third option, or how do you like list them out?
That's correct. That's a good question. This is multi-layered again. So I say it doesn't matter. Where you go to. So I looked at a rank at the last. After I got all my admits, I was hoping on this. So LMU was my last admit. So they start last and end last. So I was hoping I'd get LMU. I got LMU because, again, it depends on. So master's is going to be like a bunch of courses, and you're going to do a thesis for 6 months in Europe. So, and you need to look at the fee and the surrounding environment as well. So it doesn't matter where you do your master's, as long as you do the stuff that you set out to do. If you want to rank it, depends on a lot of factors again. The city where you want to go to. How is the city? Does that fit your, you know, relaxation profile? Does it suit your, you know, standard of what? So I like a little calmer city where, you know, few people are there. Basically, I think most people would agree with me. So a city or a town where few people are there and the architecture is good and the, you know, the natural scenic beauty is good, I guess. Anyways, I'm not going to go out that much. Okay. I do still tend to go out in a very organized way. Just don't roam around. I go out in an organized way. It depends on you. But I took Munich because Munich is a very bustling city. So okay. I don't know why I took it. But okay, fine. I think I want to break from this, you know, introverted mold. I want to go out of it. So that was one more reason that I took Munich. And again, the next thing is I wanted to, you know, study where these legends, these gods study. That's sort of a personal view of mine. So I'm saying you not to apply to a place just because you want to study in that country. I mean, I don't need to tell this to you guys, right? This is for people who want to earn money, that's it.
Okay.
So that earning money is not enjoyment, actually, in my humble opinion. It's not like enjoyment. So enjoyment is basically whatever you should be able to. So for me, at least enjoyment is, I want to be a general connoisseur of stuff. So okay. I want to do stuff, whatever that interests me at any point in time and in any place.
So at any time, you should be able to like go back and think about what you've done, and you should feel, okay, fine.
Yeah, you should not feel regret. So you should be able to do whatever you want.
Okay.
I should be able to pursue my other hobbies as well. Right. If you have hobbies, you should pursue them. You should do them because that makes you happy. You do them. Okay. If your work, so that's not living. So that's not survival. You just survive. That's not you're not doing just physics. You need to enjoy physics as well. If you start at it. So it's gonna be hard again. But still, wherever you choose, don't choose just based on the, so, and don't ask these questions like where, which university will be good to some person. Okay, don't ask these questions. That's that in my opinion is the dumbest question. I always say there's no dumb questions in physics. Technically, dumb questions when you're trying to learn, but this is the dumbest question because you put in the effort to research universities. Look at the professors. Look at the courses they might have offered. I mean, the courses don't matter. They're not the same in every university throughout the country and throughout the world. Okay, you just need to get a degree. That's why you go to a place. You just need to get a degree. You just need to. So at least my perception is that a degree is going to incentivize learning in a very short period. Shorter than what you normally learn in your own pace.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's an incentive. And socializing experience, you talk to people about research, you talk to people about life, you talk to people, you interact with people. Hmm. So, I say that go for, I don't want to throw shade on America or something. Try to economically as well, fund you, try to minimize.
And make sure you're at the end of the day, you're standing on your own legs or something like that.
You can. So India, the Indian parenting system, the Indian culture is in such a way that your parents will definitely help you. And your parents will definitely help you set up stuff. And it's not like, so people think about Western culture all the time and people confuse them. You need to stand on your own legs. No. So you're going to study. You're going to study for 2 years. Study. Then PhD will come in. You'll get a stipend and you can manage on your own. Just work through the PhD. PhD is where I think even I have certain things to think about. A lot of things to think about because I'm not doing PhDs. I think you can ask some of PhD students who, made the way. But the one thing that I've asked PhD students, how they, the same thing that you asked now. I used to ask this to PhD students back when I was in the first year. So that's a bad question again. This is the time I need to ask those questions. Whatever you're asking me, this is the correct time. I guess you're in your fourth year, right?
Third year.
So this is the time you have to inquire about all these, the nuances. How do you get into masters? How do you choose and stuff? Actually, you don't need to, specialize in masters. Also, you can chill around. Don't try to take a specialized masters. Take a free masters, but you try to specialize your own system. I don't like people telling me what to do. Okay, if you have a stream of things, if you have, I hate compulsory courses. I'm gonna do those courses anyway. Fine.
Yeah.
I don't like the concept of a compulsory course. I don't know. So if you tell me what to do, I won't do it. So this is what it means. So the base experimental concepts are going to be theoretical when you go higher. You don't need to do those. Correct. It's just a ancient method. You're not going to do that ancient method.
Okay.
But it's going to be theory. As you go higher in experimental sophistication, this becomes a theory. This becomes theoretical. That's what I'm trying to say. So just do, don't do whatever course you want to do. I've seen people take number theory and stuff. It interests them, but does it help you in the whole, final agenda? I don't know. I think that the professor, a particular professor, is very interested in multidisciplinary approaches. So he'll give you, Satya sir, he'll give you, problems in that particular field. And you have to have a look at your GPA as well. Maybe GPA is more important than writing an exam, I would say.
Is GPA something that actually factors in a lot when you apply?
Yeah, that's how they, filter out the people, right? There are too many applications. And again, my professor used to say this to me. It's basically a lottery ticket. You apply how many ever places you want to apply to, and you will get in any of them. It's going to be a lottery ticket. It's not, it doesn't put, numerical value on your skill or your thing. So you apply everything. So statistically, you apply everywhere and anyway, it's going to average to a nice place. So you try to apply to a lot of places and try to take a look at, the right efficiently, manage where you apply. So I think if you guys contact me personally, I would say a lot more details on these, how do you approach stuff personally for you. That particular person, it's not a general topic that I might give. Personally, I can say, if you're interested in this topic, try. So also contact professors, please. Ask professors in the particular field you might be interested in, the broad interesting field that you might be interested in. ask those professors where they think good research is going on, good conducive research environment is present, and ask those professors, you consult them and try to figure out where they want you to apply. You'll find a way, you'll find something. Europe, I'd say everybody will get into a university. It depends on which level of university you'll get into, but you'll definitely get into a university.
Okay.
Yeah. In India, that's not the case. You're not guaranteed a university unless you pass that damn exam.